Welcome to another episode of Youth Diary. ENT is a specialty which deals with the problems of ear, nose and throat. And today we have Dr. Praveen with us. He's an ENT and head and neck surgeon at Lakshmi Hospital, Tripunitra. Hello, Doctor.
Hello.
Welcome to our show.
Thank you.
Doctor, can you just tell us what are the common problems that we see in youth?
As you have already mentioned, ENT department deals with the disease of ear, nose and throat. When it comes to ear, the most common problems that patients come to us with are feeling of ear blockage, difficult to hear, ear discharge, and sometimes vertigo. By vertigo, we mean so many things. It can be so many things, a giddiness, a feeling of being lost in the environment, feeling of spinning, and things like that. And when it comes to the nose, the most common disease that we encounter is sinusitis. Then we deal with nasal polyps, and certain difficult situations like CSF leaks, that is the leaking of fluid from the brain through the nose. And as an extension of our area, we also deal with diseases of the skull base, like tumors of the pituitary gland and things like that. And when you come to the throat, the most common symptoms are pain of the throat, tonsillitis, change in voice, and there's a new area coming up like a professional voice, management of professional voice, like the voice problems affecting singers and anchors, advocates and people who use their voice a lot.
Okay.
And things. And another area is swallowing disorders, like patients who are bedridden with strokes, they will have problems like with difficulty in swallowing. And we deal with swallowing disorders and difficulty in breathing,
okay,
usually caused by cancers of the throat, which later on present as difficulty in breathing. So these are the common areas where an ENT surgeon can help.
Okay. So, Doctor, we'll go to the questions.
Yeah, please.
Hi, myself Mahesh, doing MJMC at Amrita School of Arts and Science. Now, my question is, what is sinusitis? What are the symptoms? How can it be detected and what are the possible management techniques to be adopted for this year?
Okay, so that's a good question, probably a long question, which I'll try to answer shortly. So before answering what is sinusitis, let me briefly describe what are sinuses. Paranasal sinuses are a group of hollow air-containing spaces that are connected to the nose. And the lining of the paranasal sinuses is continuous with the lining of the nasal cavity. And it is lined by specialized cells which have a brush-like structure on their top. So these are called cilia. So the main function of the nose and paranasal sinuses are that help us to purify the nose, purify the air that we breathe in. And secondly, it maintains the temperature of the inhaled air to body temperature, so that depending upon the climate outside, it either heats or cools down the inhaled air to be that of the normal body temperature. And the third thing that happens through the nose is the humidification. That is, it adds to the moisture content of the inhaled air. So these are the main functions of the nose. And the paranasal sinuses also help to reduce the weight of the skull. And in a way, it protects the brain, so that when you meet with an accident, so it acts as a shock absorber, so that it protects the brain. And it takes up most of the force that patient, especially in the case of an road traffic accident. And the third thing is it lends resonance to the voice. The normal voice that comes out through the throat is modified by the paranasal sinuses to give that final quality. So that jokingly we can say my voice and Tarsetan's voice is one and the same, exactly the same. But the output, the final output, the final quality of Tarsetan's voice is because of the structures of his paranasal sinuses. So in a way, it lends resonance to the voice that comes out through the throat. So these are the main functions of the paranasal sinuses. And when the paranasal sinuses are infected or inflamed, this condition is called sinusitis. So normally, around 700 milliliters of fluid secretions that we call mucus is being constantly produced inside the paranasal sinus.
That is a normal mechanism.
Okay. It's a very normal, every day, every person produces about 700 ml of normal secretions that we call the mucus. And it is interestingly transported in a peculiar way to the natural opening of the paranasal sinuses to the nose. So we have four sets of paranasal sinuses. The one situated in the region of the forehead, we call it frontal sinus. The second one, maxillary sinus, is situated just below the eye on either side of the nose. And between the nose and the eye, you have the ethmoid sinuses. It is actually a group of sinuses and can vary in number, size and shape. So these are the ethmoid sinuses, and the fourth set is the sphenoid sinus, which we have just beneath the skull or at the posterior or the posteriormost end of the nasal cavity. So these are the four set of sinuses: frontal sinus, maxillary sinus, ethmoid sinuses and the sphenoid sinus. So all these secretions that are being produced inside these sinuses is transported by means of the ciliary transport mechanism to the natural ostia of these sinuses. By ostia we mean small pores through which these secretions pour out into the nose. So when there is a block affecting any of these transport areas, there is a stagnation of secretion. When these secretions are stagnated, they act as a breeding ground for bacteria, viruses and other. So the normal secretions, that mucus, gets transformed to pus. So in this situation we call it sinusitis. So the main causes of sinusitis are two. One is infection and second is allergy. A lot of other factors also contribute to the genesis of sinusitis. Like as I mentioned earlier, all the transport mechanism as transport pathways from different sinuses meet at a common point within the nose. This important area is called the osteometal unit. And this is a junction where so many different types of diseases can be affected. Like there can be congenital abnormalities of the bone of that area, which might cause difficult blockage of this mucociliary transport pathway, which predispose the patient to sinusitis. So some patients who do not have these predisposing factors, it is very easy to treat sinusitis in those patients. But another set of patients who have these predisposing factors, we need to manage sinusitis in a more aggressive manner. So dependingly, we have two types of sinusitis. One is called the acute sinusitis and the chronic sinusitis. The acute sinusitis, it is usually seen as an extension of common cold. Like you have fever, headache, nasal block and watery nasal discharge. And when it goes on to become sinusitis, the pattern of the symptoms might change. Like the headache becomes more intense, the nasal discharge becomes more thicker, it will be more yellowish or greenish and sometimes blood tinged. And sometimes the patient might have throat pain. It can be associated with throat pain. So acute sinusitis is something which develops very fast, extension of the common cold, and presenting to the doctor with severe headache, nasal block, thick nasal discharge. These patients can usually be managed with medicines alone. So yeah, for the management of bacterial sinusitis, we give antibiotics, and to reduce the swelling within the nose, we give decongestants and antihistaminics and medicines like that. So with medicines, most of them get back. Get